everyone, and welcome back to Kerbal Space Program RP-1. My space program has reached the lunar exploration era. Right now, you can witness the experimental Lunar Orbiter. It's the first time ever to attempt such a feat. Triglav rocket delivers the AJ-10 powered upper stage to low Earth orbit. The stage will be responsible for translunar ejection burn. Said burn is planned to get the probe just over the lunar surface. Engine lights up, and 3139 meters per second burn is underway. Then, a small correction burn using the RCS thrusters sets the craft for the precise approach. Then, the fun part starts. Probe has no guidance, so right after the TLI, I plan the braking burn, that will be performed by three small solid motors. Before separating for the upper stage, probe is aimed for the maneuver node and spun up to ensure that it will not change its attitude during the coast phase. Now, the last thing to do is to fire the SRBs in the proper moment. Fortunately, plan was executed nominally and first lunar orbiter has successfully begun to send data from orbit. What you can see now is another Triglav launching another lunar orbiter, but this time a bit more advanced one. Some improvements in technology made it possible to increase the payload capacity for TLI, thanks to which a small, hypergolic thruster was used as braking stage. It allows for far more precise insertion and much tighter lunar orbit. As before, maneuver is planned and then executed. And again, probe is spin stabilized before separation, as it still lacks deep space avionics. And, as I've mentioned, a pressure-fed thruster is used for braking burn. It's less mass-effective, but it has a huge advantage. It can be turned off at will. Thanks to that, I've managed to get a low, circular orbit and complete the contract. Time to get back to Earth. A new satellite is just being launched. Its task is to make high quality photographs of our planet. Mokosh is a perfect fit for such payload to safely get to 250 by 250 km orbit. Then, the camera separates and it proceeds with making nice orbital documentation. when the film canister is exhausted, camera orients itself retrograde, and the fairing is discarded to reveal the re-entry port. Small engine lights up to lower the orbit, and then, after a slight spin up, re-entry port is released. And then, some minutes later, it lands safely using parachutes. Afterwards, film was extracted and examined. After the short break, we come back to the lunar operations. We are launching yet another lunar orbiter, but this time, even more advanced. Launch is analogous to the previous ones. Triglav rocket gets the transfer stage to LEO, and the maneuver is planned to get to a nice polar approach. Executed and the orbiter separates. As you can see, it is solar powered and additionally it's fully guided, so it can stay around the moon for much longer and to gather far more science. After reaching our natural satellite, orbiter performs braking burn. And then, after getting to the planned orbit, it reorients towards the sun for a continuous power supply, needed to support science equipment and antenna. Next launch is an important milestone in space exploration. It is the first unmanned test of a crewed capsule. Mokos rocket with two additional solid boosters is responsible for getting this valuable payload to orbit. The ascent was quite hot, with capsule almost reaching maximum rated temperature. It's a lesson for future launches to plan for more conservative gravity turn. Fortunately, capsule reaches the orbit and separates from the upper stage. Then, it stays in orbit for a full revolution. For the deorbit burn, a set of three SRBs is used. They provide just enough an impulse to get into proper re-entry trajectory. Retropack is decoupled and the capsule is on its way to come back to Earth. The mission ends up with a splashdown, and it seems that everything is ready for a crewed flight. But before that, we have a first launch of a new powerful parent rocket. This 350 tons machine is designed for deep space operations. For its first stage, it uses 6 LR-87 engines. Second stage uses LR-87 as well, yet only single one, and with vacuum optimized nozzle. The most important innovation is the third stage. It uses Hydrolux powered RL-10. This extremely efficient engine is a perfect choice for high energy trajectories like interplanetary, translunar and geostationary destinations. And the destination of this test launch is the Lander. To get to the geostationary orbit, the first burn takes place at the equatorial node. It is to raise the apoapsis to 35,786 kilometers. Then the final kick stage separates, and another maneuver is planned. This time it is responsible for a circularization and reducing inclination to zero. The first geostationary satellite has been successfully put into proper orbit, and it has become operational. Next task for Perun is to deliver Lunar Lander to the Moon. It will be the first attempt to soft landing on anybody outside of Earth. Translunar maneuver is planned, and the Earl 10 lights up. When in proper trajectory, the braking stage separates. First off, it enters the low lunar orbit. Then it makes the main landing burn, cancelling nearly all of its velocity. Braking stage separates and begins several successive burns before completing a touchdown. The solar panels are extended and all scientific instruments begin their operation. Sweet science is being transmitted back to Earth. Last launch for this video is a dual geostationary launch using Perun once again. Thanks to some engine upgrades, third stage separates just before reaching orbital velocity, which means more delta V to use for next maneuvers. First one of 2.5 km per second gets the craft to proper altitude, and another one of 1.8 km per second is for circularization and inclination change. The first satellite is being separated very gently. Then, the upper stage plans for a final burn that will increase the orbital period by 4 hours to ensure a nice spread of 90 degrees. After completing another orbit, second satellite with a small bus separates and it proceeds with a circularization maneuver. And we have another gentle separation. Thanks to such a dual launch, the contract requiring 4 satellites in a geostationary orbit can be completed building just 2 rockets, so it brings the cost down significantly. That would be all for today. Thank you everyone for watching. Please press like and subscribe if you enjoyed it, and see you again in my next video.